For those who were here during the first panel session, I think we have a challenge. First, they were right on time. Second, I thought the conclusions and the answers were very appropriate as a prelude to our session. Number one, we're focusing on before the event, and that's the name of resilience. You have to prepare for the event, adapt, change the attitudes of the people and the behavior, and then transform so that we truly become resilient. The second point that I think came out loud and clear in the first session is whether it's a 4-to-1 ratio between the private sector participation having 1 and the government having 4, and I think that's a figure with Katrina or what have you. The reality is, in a developing country like the Philippines, they have to invest before the fact, and they have to do substantially more, in my opinion, rather than 4-to-1. And in many ways, Mr. Mary of PDRF brought that up. And secondly, the PDRF is a private sector conglomerate. There's many more that can participate. And we have to motivate the private sector a great deal more to be devoid of partisan commercial competition when it comes to resilience. And I think you know what I mean in that respect. I was scheduled on a video to listen, and I was supposed to harangue you for 7 minutes. But in reality, I think I would have done you a disservice, because I think it's more important that we do it in the context of a brief summary as a background, and then we'll have more discussion. And that's, I think, the name of the game. So, before I proceed, let me just say I'm delighted that Secretary Singson is here, because I consider him a role model public servant, despite the fact that he went to the wrong school, because he went to La Salle and I went to Ateneo. And second, we know the difference between North and South. But Mr. Cuisia and Mr. Secretary Singson wouldn't know that, all right? So let me, and let me show you 2 slides here that we have that basically says that that's the name of the game as far as we're concerned. Prepare, adapt, transform. And we had this video that basically said, and Mrs. Loizaga there helped me prepare it. But in essence, it was the Zulig Family Foundation, the Romulo Foundation, and the Manila Observatory that has worked on this project, this 3-year project that we are now starting as of last July, but will bear fruition hopefully in starting January. Now, we all know the Philippines. It's rich natural resources, et cetera, thriving economy, and we claim we're also the fastest growing economy in Asia, and we can argue that point, but we are moving forward. Now, in 2013, the figures will show 80% of all deaths from disasters were in Asia, of which 7,000 to 8,000 of these deaths were related to the Philippines' Typhoon Yolanda. And it affected millions more. And indeed, the country suffered economic damages equivalent to more or less 5% of GDP. Now, disaster experts at the UN University have identified the Philippines a second only to Vanuatu in 2014 in the context of vulnerability to disasters. Swiss Re also categorizes as number 2, depending on what you look at. So if you look at our large population and our institutional weaknesses in coping and long-term adaptive capacity, persistent poverty, income inequality, inadequate infrastructure, and indeed, environmental degradation, it makes us extremely vulnerable to earthquakes, and I say that again, earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, tropical cyclones, and floods. Now, global climate change will impact the Philippines in many ways. Atmospheric scientists note that while the number of tropical cyclones making landfall has not changed. We have had more super typhoons and extreme rainfall events in the last 30 years than ever before in our history. And the rise of sea levels all over the country compound these events. Three sea levels, which is about three times that of the average. Now, 9 out of 12 largest cities are built along the coast, which is to be expected because we are an archipelago. And more people live in cities today than ever before. And by 2015, these millions will depend on them for economic survival, and metropolitan Manila is expected to include 24 to 25 million people. That's a phenomenal amount of people that we have to worry about. Again, think about our earthquakes. Now, we're building our cities in low elevation coastal zones where we also draw water for domestic and industrial use. And the shape and length of our coast, lab subsidence, tides, and sea level rise are exposing our cities to floods and storm surges. Now, rapid economic growth is no match to our urbanization, environmental degradation, weak governance systems, and high income inequality. In 2011, and this is an interesting figure, the increased wealth of top families equaled 75% of the increase in annual GDP, while 42 million live on less than $2 per day. The poor bear a disproportionate level of risk and rely principally on each other for support during disasters. And we have not learned from history, as records show. Many places like Leyte and Samar have been hit by extreme weather events over the last 130 years. And they're shocked. We've even shown pictures of it, of the past. And we continue to build our towns and cities in the same sites. And as has been explained earlier, that we're trying to change that attitude. Again, it's attitude and practice. As our environment changes, our society and economy should also. We need to prepare for hazards that we know, adapt to changes around us, transform the trajectory of risk, and prepare for alternative futures. The private sector, as I said earlier, is uniquely positioned to drive this transformation. And the resilience partnership that we are envisaging for the next 3 years will try to lead cross-sectoral dialogues to build a shared understanding of resilience in terms of preparedness, adaptation, and transformation. And I think at the end of the day, this is what we're talking about today. Now, I am the moderator, and I shall try to also time them so that they will speak 5 minutes only each, as were the previous speakers. So forgive me, but time management is my concern because we cannot lose face compared to the other panel. Let me just say that you have before you the program. We have a distinguished set of panelists, including one from this other university called LaSalle. Let me just say that, let me read out, besides Secretary Singson, we have Dr. Charles Anenson and Ms. Bernier Toth, and one who's associated with me, Antonio Yulo Loizaga, it shows you what they are. So without further statements from me, you've heard enough, and I hope I spoke less than 7 minutes. May I ask the first panelist, Secretary Singson, to give his comments.
Thank you,
and
Ben.
I would welcome, even after Secretary Singson talks, if there's a question, they can ask him because he's the government. Let him answer all the government questions.
That's fine. Thank you very much, Secretary Romulo. Let me just say that even before Typhoon Haiyan occurred, we were already in the process of building resiliency in the program of government. In fact, we were ready to start piloting the concept by building, identifying in each municipality in the disaster-prone areas, specifically on the eastern seaboard, either a school site, a hospital, or a municipal structure to be able to come up with a resilient structure, meaning to us engineers, when we say resilient structure, we mean that that building should be functioning during and after an event. So the design has to be changed. You have to provide that particular evacuation center with enough backup power, telecommunications, as well as backup on the staff. Because as you can see, what happened in Yolanda, the hospital personnel themselves were victims. Police themselves were the victims. So we had to bring in people from all over the country to be able to operate these facilities. So when we say resilient structure, not just physically, but also the staffing that will back up the. So when this Yolanda happened, it provided us an opportunity to be able to reconstruct. Rather than go on a pilot mode, we decided to go full blast. And that's why the position taken by the president was build back better. Now, having said that, we have part of what we've done is agree within the national government that there should only be one agency. How many minutes do I have? Is that 5 minutes?
No, 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 no.
Or is that somebody calling you? Okay. Well, anyway, the Build Back Better policy, in fact, came in place. The issue of flood management, we already agreed in the cabinet that when we address flooding, it cannot be based on political boundaries. A river basin system has to be addressed in its totality, from upstream to downstream. So the approach to flood management, water resources management, was brought to the president. Mr. President, there are some 30 agencies involved in water. We have to do structural, institutional restructuring of these 30 or so agencies. And that's why the president approved the creation of a water board, a cabinet-level water board, so that we address water resource management in an integrated and coherent manner rather than each agency doing its own thing. I'll stop at that.
Thank you very much. If there are no questions at this point, can we move on to Mr. Anderson?
Sure. First, I'd like to thank Ambassador Romulo. As well as Director Hendrickson for inviting me to participate in this workshop. Peace Wins America. We're an organization about 6 years old. As a result of working with USAID for about 20, 30 years, we realized that disasters can stop economic growth. Disasters can result in lost lives or in leadership, especially within the Asia-Pacific region, where about 60% of disasters happen. My last post was in Japan, and I realized that Japan and US are the big responders, complemented by Australia, if it's in the South Pacific, and often UK, sometimes Korea. In the last few years, it's now China. But the two big responders are US and Japan. How to increase their efficiency through cooperation, knowing more about each other. We began a program in 2009. We were funded by the Japan Foundation, as well as Carnegie, and we brought together the Japanese military, NGOs, their gaimusho, or their Ministry of Foreign Affairs, their private sector, meeting with USAID, our military, our NGOs. So they got to know each other's limitations as well as capabilities. So they knew the strengths of each other, and they knew the weaknesses. They knew the timelines of each other. This, we thought, would strengthen our bilateral alliance. And last year, we put together a report, which you're welcome to read on our website, or you could contact my colleague, John Ehrenfeld. For this report, Strengthening the Alliance, how the militaries can work together, how the NGOs, how AID can work with JICA. We then approached Asakawa Peace Foundation and Carnegie and Japan Foundation and said, we want a third partner, the most vulnerable within Asia Pacific. We want to partner with the Philippines. The Philippines, we see as not only a host nation or a recipient nation, but also can be a donor nation. The Philippines, on a study that was done in 2012, has an above average disaster framework among the ASEAN countries, has an above average response mechanism. They have probably the best community organization. So we envision the three of us responding to other ASEAN disasters. So that was the vision of our 2013-2015 Japan, US, Philippines Civil Military Disaster Preparedness Initiative. Concerning Haiyan.
You have 30 seconds, huh?
Really? Okay. We responded to Haiyan, and as you can see, the second point here is our partners in that initiative. The difficulty in Haiyan and how we can make this more resilient is on the point coordination issues. There are four pillars, as you can read. DSWD is response, preparedness is DLIG, local government. How to get them to communicate together? This is the issue. When they set up operation centers, get them to set up a joint operation center. The UN wants to set up their own. Every ministry has a tendency to set up its own. The military sets up its own. If we want to have resilience, we have to change these policies. All the ministries said they need to know more about AFP, how AFP or the the Armed Forces of the Philippines can complement their efforts. AFP is strong, but how can they work with DSWD? DSWD needs to know the capabilities, the timeline, the weaknesses. Then how do we integrate with the US and with Japan? The US military, they were there before it happened, and they were there 2 days after. The Japanese are very slow. Well, let's build on that. Let's
focus more on resilience. You've gone over time, but your points are very well taken, and I think we can bring it up during the question period also.
Okay.
All right?
Thank you.
Thank you. Michelle, please.
Thank you, and I will talk quickly. I would like to thank CSIS and the U.S. Philippine Society for the opportunity and the honor to be here. And I'd like to provide some reflections on how the U.S. worked with the government of the Philippines to respond to Typhoon Haiyan and what we have done and will do and are doing to prepare for the next disaster, because as we have heard, there is always the next disaster. The U.S. government began preparing for Haiyan before the storm made landfall. The U.S. State Department sent out warning messages to U.S. citizens. The Peace Corps moved its volunteers out of harm's way, and our embassy in Manila convened a U.S. mission-wide meeting to coordinate our preparations. USAID mobilized its Office of Foreign Disaster Assistance team, and in partnership with the embassy, coordinated the whole of U.S. government response and relief operation. Here in Washington, our principal Deputy Assistant Secretary for East Asia Pacific Affairs met with the Philippine ambassador and others to put into place an outline of what became a major relief operation that saved countless lives. One of the State Department's highest priorities is protecting the safety and security of U.S. citizens abroad. The Philippines is home to hundreds of thousands of U.S. citizens, many of them dual nationals. Haiyan's impact quickly made it clear to us that a major U.S. government response would be needed. And let me highlight some of the actions that we took and our consular officers on the ground in the Philippines took in particular, in Manila, in Leyte, and elsewhere. We helped coordinate transportation for more than 21,000 victims, not all of them U.S. citizens, obviously, including hundreds of U.S. citizens, out of Tacloban. Embassy teams helped U.S. citizens board aircraft, and upon arrival in safe havens, arranged emergency shelter and medical care for those who needed it. We investigated and resolved inquiries from frantic relatives in the United States who were desperate for information about their loved ones in the affected area. We had over 1,200 inquiries all told. Concert teams deployed when they could to Leyte and Eastern Samar to search those disaster zones. We literally sent people door to door, or if there was a door there to knock on. They located hundreds of U.S. citizens and helped the survivors contact their loved ones in the United States to allay their concerns. And not least of all, we assisted the families of the 10 U.S. citizens who died and the presumed fatalities as a result of the typhoon. And finally, we worked with the Department of Homeland Security to expedite immigration visa processing for the families of U.S. citizens who had been affected by the disaster. As an example of our coordination with the Philippine government, Philippine officials contacted the embassy for help in transporting 9 orphaned children from the typhoon zone who were in the process of being adopted by U.S. families. U.S. and Philippine officials ensured that these children were transported to Manila on a U.S. military flight as soon as possible. Our hearts go out to the thousands of families who lost their loved ones in the storm and the 4.1 million who were displaced. The United States shares close historic and people-to-people ties with the Philippines, and we were among the first international responders. Our embassy in Manila served as a center for coordination and communication with other agencies, Philippine authorities, private organizations, and international partners. Once the storm hit, the State Department, USAID, and the U.S. military, working closely with the U.S. Embassy in Manila, coordinated a swift and effective response. USAID mobilized food assistance to 3 million Filipinos and shelter and medical supplies to tens of thousands. The U.S. military quickly deployed major resources to the Philippines, which were essential in the initial relief effort. At its peak, U.S. military efforts included more than 13,400 military personnel, 66 aircraft, and 12 naval vessels, through which the United States delivered more than 2,495 tons of relief supplies to about 450 sites. The State Department set up a task force in Washington to monitor and report on developments, identify and overcome obstacles to both relief and evacuation efforts, facilitate coordination with other agencies, and respond to public inquiries. This effort managed thousands of phone calls, kept U.S. citizens and their loved ones informed of what was happening, and received inquiries about affected U.S. citizens. This domestic response allowed embassy staff to focus on the ground activities that they needed to do. The idea of resiliency is something that we in consular affairs take very seriously. Mm-hmm. We talk a lot about it. So I was pleased that we'd have the chance to come here and talk today. We are constantly striving to build the resilience not only of our consular teams, they're my responsibility, but that of our international partners. The State Department believes that this is especially important in a country such as the Philippines that is so unfortunately prone to natural disasters. A key element of resiliency is preparedness, as we have heard, and the United States has a long-standing partnership with the Philippines on disaster response. We work closely with a range of government officials in the Philippines to help strengthen their abilities to prepare for and respond to natural disasters. For example, under the Visiting Forces Agreement, humanitarian assistance and disaster response activities are major elements of our frequent joint military exercises. These efforts ensure that the U.S. and Philippine personnel, both military and civilian, can work together when disaster strikes. Helping countries prepare for natural disasters ensures our partners are better able to manage and recover when they inevitably occur and minimizes the human suffering when they do. We look forward to continuing this partnership with our counterparts in the Philippines. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michelle. Mrs. Loizaga.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. And I'd like to thank the Carlos P. Romulo Foundation, the Zwilling Foundation, and the U.S.-Philippine Society for allowing us the opportunity to be part of this event. I'm from the Ateneo, so I hope you'll be a little bit lenient with me, Ambassador Romulo. For those of you who don't know, the Manila Observatory, we were established almost 150 years ago by a fellow named Padre Faura, who was a Jesuit priest, who was the first leader of the PAGASA, and the FIVOX, which is the Seismological Observation Bureau in the Philippines. Recently, Ambassador Goldberg mentioned at the first joint committee meeting of the U.S.-Philippine Science and Technology Agreement that the first scientific collaborator with the Philippines in the Philippines was the Manila Observatory, and he gave the year 1901. Actually, it was 1898, I believe, or whenever the Battle of Manila Bay was, because Admiral Dewey had sent for weather information from the Manila Observatory. The Spanish director of the observatory gave him the information, was immediately stripped of his citizenship, and he became a stateless person, since Spain said he was a collaborator with the enemy. Just a very quick review of the concepts that we're talking about today, and I'm using today the USAID definition because there is a national definition, I understand, from the national imperative. Institutions that are involved in a shock or an event. But in the definition for developing countries, the USAID has actually made it a point to mention chronic vulnerability, which is in fact the condition of many of the developing countries, including the Philippines, and the ability to facilitate inclusive growth once, in fact, resilience has been people. And the key words in both definitions are, in fact, vulnerability, which pre-exists any hazard from hitting a country like the Philippines. What do we know, and what did the Manila Observatory do during Haiyan? We did three things, principally. We produced the science. We issued a report on November 7, which mentioned, among others, the strength, the speed, and the magnitude of the possible disaster. The information was available from all international sources we collated. We run our own models and our tracks. This is the NOAA image that was released, and we issued the report. We are not a warning agency, and therefore we released it to our partners, among them mayors, who in fact used it in their evacuation plans. Consequently, they did encounter and they have zero casualty in their municipalities. The second thing we did is we worked with the military, and I'll speak a little bit more about that later. The boundaries of the debris field, which would in fact help us determine where the hotspots were for search and rescue. And I'll talk about that in my succeeding slides. Immediately, once we had the computation of the hazard, we looked at the tracks and we mapped poverty incidents in the country, really looking at poverty as part of vulnerability of coastal populations as well as inland populations. As you see there, some are in fact, as Dr. Garilao had mentioned earlier, is among the poorest provinces in the country. We also looked at the possibility of inundation of low elevation coastal zones. This information is in fact available, and we were able to overlay where potentially the wave might hit. Next, as you can see, the entire area built up of Tacloban is in fact within almost entirely within the 5-meter low elevation coastal zone. Assessment and a post-disaster needs assessment program for the AFP. This is principally with J7, the civil military unit of the AFP, which is located all over the country. One of the first people to hit the ground after Haiyan was a young major, Major Ruben Ginalbay, who had seen extensive experience in Basilan. In my interviews with him, he was asked early in the morning to deploy immediately to Tacloban, and General Suerte, head of J7, said, "Give us an assessment." These were his exact words. "There's nothing to assess. Sir, send everything." He said he had never seen the extent of devastation that he saw in this area. And in fact, all the years that he said he worked in Basilan and he fought in Basilan, he had never seen the amount of deaths that he saw in this area. The other point that we tried to raise, in fact, working with the AFP, was where was the search and rescue operation? In interviews with governors and mayors who in fact sent their very capable search and rescue teams, the response was common. There was no organization on the ground for search and rescue. They were sent wherever they could go in order to conduct their own separate search and rescue operations. So this, in fact, in conversations with everyone who talk about relief, search and rescue is the first order of the day. There was no coordinated search and rescue operation. The work with the military really centered on, not with the work with the US forces, but the work with 12 foreign militaries who, in fact, offered their aircraft and their goods and landed these in the Mactan Air Base. This became the joint center for all the foreign militaries working with J7 and the Air Force, and in fact hosted all these 12 foreign militaries and their aircraft. Two things are notable about this exercise. When we arrived there on Wednesday, which was 5 days after, there was no setup in the office. There were no facilities. And immediately, with the help of other militaries and the UN and the World Food Program, an operation was supported, basically by basic tables and chairs, computers, and connections. If you look at the air condition on the right-hand side, you'll see a wire sticking through that right beside the air conditioning that brought in the Wi-Fi router. I was there when they actually drilled the hole into the wall to make the wider router actually connect and provide Wi-Fi operations. You'll also see a young man who is obviously not a Filipino in that picture. That young man is a fellow by the name of Luke Beckman. He works here at the American Red Cross, and the Manila Observatory brought him in to embed him deliberately with this group under the command of General De Varaturda and Colonel Santiago of J7. He was among the first people who landed in Haiti during the right after the earthquake. Luke actually set up the logistics coordinating mechanism for all the 12 foreign militaries and the AFP. They were flying out up to 1 million pounds of goods a day out of this operation, all with the help of a Google Docs system. I could see who was taking off and landing hourly at my room in Manila. And basically, he approached all the different foreign militaries together with the Filipino AFP, and every day they would set up 2 meetings in order to know who would fly out the next day and carrying what and to where, to the 3 different operating airfields in Giwan, Tacloban, and Ormoc. So I think that this is a very little known story, but in fact, this particular operation supported 12 different countries' aid to the Philippines. And one should also note that none of these countries first donated the services of their aircraft. The negotiations for the use of aircraft were done on the ground in Mactan. Then it was cascaded upwards to the different embassies. The generals and the colonels who run this operation individually negotiated with the countries before the countries sought permission from their State Departments or their equivalent of the State Department. So all this aid actually happened on an ad hoc basis. And I think that's something that we need to address when we look at reforms in the AFP and collaboration with foreign militaries. The last bit of my presentation is the question really that people ask. Can a Haiyan happen in Metro Manila? And the scientists have answered, certainly. Manila Bay is shallow. It is also a concave bay. And definitely, much of Manila is below sea level. So certainly, Haiyan is possible in Metro Manila. However, and I think, and this is something that the ambassador has mentioned, we worry most about the earthquakes at the moment. The JICA study, and it's been updated now by an Australian grant called the Risk Analysis Project, note that, in fact, Metro Manila may be separated into four different sections. And you see the PhilVox in the middle there. That's a poster, which is a visualization of a separation of Metro Manila in a 7.2 earthquake. What the observatory is doing is pointing out, not only do we look at structural measures, and with all due respect to Secretary Singson, there have been retrofitting of bridges and critical infrastructure in Metro Manila. We're looking at the social dynamics of a post-disaster situation. The intersections between the physical science and the social science need to be examined here. On the exposure slide, you see the density. Where are all the high density areas in Metro Manila? The redder, the higher the density. And you'll see that these are mostly along the coasts. The fastest growing barangays in Metro Manila are the barangays along the port. They are growing at 10% a year. And these are largely slum barangays. And no one is actually paying attention to that growth. The last slide that we have here on the right, on the left, north, south, right, left, is a vulnerability slide. And this is something that we had discussed in many conversations and yesterday with Ambassador Cuisia. There are roughly 4 million informal settlements in Metro Manila, informal settlers, I'm sorry, in Metro Manila. If 10% of these individuals go in search of food and water, in the immediate aftermath of a disaster such as a major earthquake, we would have people roaming around basically looking for sustenance, similar to Tacloban, that really amount to a figure that is higher than the entire armed forces of the Philippines. So we need to pay attention to these intersections, physical and social, and begin our work for resilience really as part of state building, and not as part of a response to a severe disaster. We need to move from cooperation to collaboration. And it's an active collaboration at all levels and across all sectors. And finally, just some good news at the end. In terms of prepare, there is a US-Philippine Science and Technology Agreement. And it's just had its first joint committee meeting. Under that agreement, there are two notable projects. One is the collaboration between the Philippine government weather agencies with NOAA, N-O-A-A, and that includes really the determination of storm surge that is associated with typhoons, but hopefully that will be translated, as it is in the U.S., into a mandatory evacuation policy for different populations along the coast. In terms of adaptation, we'd like to take a good look at ADMIR, which is the ASEAN agreement on militaries' assistance to each other during disasters, that we hope to take in context of what was said earlier in the first presentation. In terms of transformation, there's an ongoing project within NASA, the Naval Research Laboratory, and the observatory, and hopefully some government agents as well, looking at the way climate is changing, specifically along in the South China Sea, as well as along Manila and in the Pacific. So that, in fact, is going to help us characterize our hazards better. On that note, I'd like to say thank you very much.
The floor is open for questions. My very smart news lady there from GMA7. Yeah.
Make it short. Make it short. Okay. Okay. I'll make it short, but I also have 3 points. Sorry. No, it's important. It's important. Okay, the first one is the emergency preparedness. One is that I was talking to Attorney Karen, and I was listening to Butch Miley, and they were saying that helping is supposed to be colorblind. So the question is that the problem with that deters the effectivity and efficiency of delivering help is the politicking of national and local leaders in the Philippines. That I have observed myself because I was involved with the Typhoon Haiyan coverage based here in Washington, D.C. A lot of the local leaders there were missing during the first days, and then when the press and the U.S. forces came, they're all in front of the photo opportunities. That's just an observation. But the second thing, too, is the economy. I mean, I was reading the World Bank report, and they're saying that in order to really build resilience and readiness, you have to work on the agricultural livelihoods and the domestic industries and really do job prospects. The point is, most Filipinos are now aspiring to be working at a call center, which shouldn't be the ideal job of a smart Filipino with our workforce. So, and the third point I have is that the OFWs, overseas foreign workers, they are the ones who are actually saving the GDP of the Philippines, as far as my research goes, because they have contributed a lot to the gross domestic product of the Philippines. But the point is, I mean, most Americans think Filipinos are fractious, but when the Typhoon Haiyan came, everyone rose to the challenge. And the point is, though, OFWs might be an untapped resource, plus the social media. Because during the coverage of the Typhoon Haiyan, I mean, a lot of our news correspondents were out there and were lost in the lack of the roads and everything. And we were pretty much tracking Twitter. We were pretty much communicating each other with social
media. Your time
media.
Is over.
Okay, thank you.
Who would like to answer the question?
Tony, go ahead, answer.
I think on the issue, somehow you're comparing apples to peaches when we talk about call center, and they're too intelligent to be in call centers. Do you want them to be farmers? But the more important point that you brought up is the fact that they're agriculture is one of the most important things in resilience, okay? Because, for example, if all the coconut trees are felled, what do? They have no source of income. It's about time we started talking to them about root crops, for example. If all the fishing boats are destroyed, do you just give them all new fishing boats? When all the coral is destroyed and there's less fish, you have to find new sources of income for them. That is the challenge of resilience. It's not just a question of building a better home. It's a question in a barangay. When you look at the total devastation and there's no source of income, it is incumbent upon us, the Filipinos, whether it's government or private sector, to develop a new economic system for them. If they develop, for example, you have a Jollibee, believe it or not. They have cooperatives all over the Philippines that does onions, everything except potatoes. For some reason, potatoes don't work in the Philippines. They have to import it. They import chili or what have you. And then they develop a system where they procure from these cooperatives. In other words, if you develop a certain product, agricultural product in farms, there has to be a farm-to-market process. And those are the kind of things that both the private sector and the government has to develop. So it's one thing, for example, Mr. Gary Lau spoke about rural health, and we focus there on Millennium Development Goals like maternal mortality, infant mortality. It's very easy. But when you get to looking at measurements for resilience, you have to look at multiple other measurements, which we have to develop ourselves. And that is one of the projects we have now, is we have to develop a metric system on how to have a resilient society. There are best practices, and we're looking at them also. But the point is, those are the challenges that resilience brings in. Whether I answered your questions or not, I hope you understand that resilience is not something that will happen overnight. What we're trying to say now is resilience is something we have to do now, and we can't wait on the next earthquake or the next Haiyan. And the other aspect is we talked about earthquake, and Tony pointed out 1 million settlers suddenly, informal settlers going out. What do we do with them? I have some very, very basic questions from Mrs. Gakowski. Does bottled water expire? It does? So in other words, if we had depots outside the Metro Manila area and we had PNG water all over, you can't keep it for an indefinite period. Is that right? Well, how interesting, yeah. But the basic message is now we have to prepare, assuming whether it's a Haiyan or an earthquake, to have depots all beyond the specific danger areas. And that is where we have to invest now. And that's, the armed forces, according to Mr. Loisaga, has pinpointed where all the helicopters can land. But they have to have relief goods, and that you can't produce overnight. So that's where the private sector also has to step in. I hope you get the twist of what I'm saying. Anyway.
We have another question. Ambassador.
If I may just add, I wanted to make the same point you did, Mr. Chairman, that resilience is not developed overnight. It takes time. And if you look at the definition that was posted by Tony, you can tell right away that it's going to take time to develop resilience. But as you said, we have to develop it now. Second is that I beg to disagree to the comment made by late that overseas Philippine workers, what's keeping the economy alive. While we appreciate the remittances of our overseas Philippine workers, it constitutes only 9% of GDP. Services sector constitutes 53% of GDP. Agriculture is 25%, and the rest is industry. So we can't say it's just, we appreciate definitely the overseas Filipino workers' remittances, but it's
call
only 9%.
Call centers provide about 13